Armenia, December 1988. A 7.0 magnitude earthquake strikes the southern region of the country. The death toll reaches 25,000. California, October 17, 1989. A 7.1 magnitude earthquake shakes the San Francisco area. The death toll stands at 75. It's just one of the many examples that could be cited. But why this disparity? Why does the earthquake in San Francisco, with the same amount of energy released, result in far fewer deaths compared to the one that struck Armenia? Many factors contribute to expanding or reducing the list of earthquake victims. However, it's hard not to notice that when the ground shakes beneath the feet of economically disadvantaged populations, the disasters have much worse effects. The reason is easily understood. The poor live in densely populated areas within homes built without regulations or inspections, using low-quality materials unable to withstand the tremors. Impoverished countries lack the resources to reinforce their 30- or 40-year-old dwellings with the latest building technologies. The poor don't have automatic devices that shut off gas or electricity, like Japan, when the tremor exceeds 4 on the Richter scale. They lack well-equipped medical facilities to promptly respond to earthquake sites, or sophisticated cranes to lift rubble. Consequently, they pay a higher price in terms of casualties. It's no coincidence that over 90% of the victims of natural disasters worldwide live in developing countries. According to statistics, the earthquake with the heaviest death toll was the one that hit Haiti in January of 2010, nearly 300,000 estimated deaths, 300,000 injured, and approximately 1 million displaced. These numbers sound like a real apocalypse for a small state already severely affected by poverty. There are countless earthquakes every day, ranging from tremors recorded only by instruments to shakes felt by the population. But where do earthquakes occur? Are there specific areas or do they originate randomly? In this meticulously crafted video, brought to you by the Insane Curiosity Channel, we'll seek to answer these questions, exploring not only how earthquakes form, but also why certain areas have a higher seismic risk than others. We'll then conclude with a roundup of useful tips for those unfortunate enough to find themselves living in a highly seismic area.
Audio Jungle.
Before discussing earthquakes, we need to provide some background on tectonic plates. What exactly are they? The Earth's crust is the outermost layer of our planet, and like a puzzle, it is divided into many plates, the famous tectonic plates. The interesting thing is that these plates are not stationary but can move over geological time. We're talking millions and hundreds of millions of years. Usually, earthquakes occur along the edges of these plates, which we can more accurately define as plate boundaries. But why do earthquakes occur precisely in these zones? Each plate has well-defined geographical boundaries, and when they move, they can interact with each other in different ways. They can collide, move apart, or slide past each other. Where they collide, compressive zones, for example, thrust faults will form, whereas where they move apart, extensional zones, normal faults will form. Even when two plates slide past each other, oblique motion faults are created, called strike-slip faults. When the two blocks of a fault move, earthquakes are triggered. So, in summary, we can say that it is possible to predict where areas have more earthquakes, namely the plate boundaries. If we compare these boundaries with the distribution of earthquakes in recent years, it is clear how the two perfectly overlap. For this reason, if we hear about an earthquake in Peru, from a scientific point of view, we shouldn't be surprised. It's quite normal since it lies along a plate boundary. Same goes for Japan, which unfortunately sits at the intersection of four different plates. But beware, outside of the plate boundaries, earthquakes are certainly rarer, but there are no seismic-free zones. There are high seismic hazard areas and low seismic hazard areas, where, however, an earthquake can still occur from time to time. An example is New Madrid, where, as explained in our video, the American town lives in an anxious anticipation of a big one, despite being distant from any fault lines. Earthquakes are by far the most powerful natural events on Earth. Quakes can release in seconds an energy greater than thousands of atomic bombs combined. Consider that an earthquake can move volumes of rock of hundreds of cubic kilometers in just seconds. It is estimated that about 500,000 detectable earthquakes occur on Earth every year. However, we humans can only perceive about one-fifth of them. The strongest earthquakes occur more frequently along the so-called Pacific Ring of Fire in places like California and Alaska in the United States, El Salvador, Mexico, Guatemala, Chile, Peru, Indonesia, the Philippines, Iran, Pakistan, Turkey, New Zealand, and Japan. Between 1 degree and the other on the Richter scale, there's a ratio of about 1 to 10, meaning that, for example, there are about 10 times more earthquakes above magnitude 4 than those of magnitude 5. For each incremental increase in magnitude, there's also an increase of about 30 times in the released energy. For instance, a magnitude 6.0 earthquake releases about 32 times more energy than a magnitude 5.0 earthquake. And a magnitude 7.0 earthquake releases 1,000 times more energy than a magnitude 5.0 earthquake. Hang on a sec, guys, before we continue. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell, you will help us to make products of even higher quality. As a result, earthquakes can cause severe devastation and high loss of human lives through a series of destructive agents. The main one being the violent movement of the ground, which can occur with accelerations that can be categorized as horizontal and vertical, resulting in the stressing of building structures, possibly accompanied by other stationary effects such as flood, dam collapses, ground collapses, landslides, avalanches or liquefaction, fires or release of hazardous materials. If the earthquake occurs beneath the ocean or near the coastline, it can generate tsunamis. In every earthquake, one or more of these agents can contribute to causing further severe damage and casualties. The strongest earthquakes, such as those in Indonesia in 2004 and Japan in 2011, can even shift the geographic North Pole by a few centimeters due to the elasticity of the Earth's crust. All of this, you'll agree with us, is truly terrible and deeply frustrating. No one enjoys feeling completely at the mercy of the elements. But is it possible that earthquakes still cannot be predicted? Unfortunately, the answer is still negative. Although it's true that some earthquakes, especially the strongest ones, are preceded by unusual natural phenomena called seismic precursors. There are countless testimonies, in fact, from people who, before a strong seismic event, swear they saw flashes or glows or observed unusual behavior in animals. Moreover, instruments have recorded sudden variations in the local magnetic, electric, or radioactivity fields due to the emission of radon gas, interference in radio communications, variations in the water table level or coastal waters, etc. Since the 19th century, variations in the height of the water table and local gravity force, as well as radon emissions, have been studied. However, at the current state of knowledge, models have not yet been developed that allow us to highlight signals useful for the effective prediction of an earthquake, or its possible characteristics, intensity, and spatiotemporal localization. Increasing radon emissions, for instance, though somehow linked to a future potential earthquake, represents just an assessment of how likely the event might be. And without almost absolute certainty, implementing extreme preventative measures, like ordering the evacuation of an area, becomes really challenging. Even monitoring any seismic swarms preceding a main event often doesn't seem to yield tangible results in terms of prediction, as the vast majority of seismic swarms either resolve without causing catastrophes or dissipate more or less slowly over time. In the current context of seismological research, the most concrete results for earthquake prediction are obtained through long-term statistical analyses, consulting risk maps that consider the return times of an earthquake in a particular area, or calculating the probability of its occurrence. However, the time interval in which an earthquake is considered likely to occur is rather broad, even spanning decades, rendering any reasonable attempt at prevention that allows for effective population evacuation futile. In short, we must accept the fact that there is no scientifically valid method to predict earthquakes in advance. That's why the only solution for defense is to intervene preventatively on existing buildings with systematic measures that secure them, preventing collapse in the event of an earthquake. Seismic risk, in fact, can only be mitigated through preventative structural reinforcement interventions on the most vulnerable buildings. Of course, if it were possible to achieve this, it would come at an extremely high cost and with very long implementation times. And it is precisely this consideration that condemns developing countries to pay the highest toll in terms of human lives. At this point, many of you might be wondering, Okay, but is there anything truly useful I could do to save my life if I suddenly found myself caught in an earthquake? Well, first and foremost, it is important to admit that all safety measures and advice found online are only valid in probabilistic terms, meaning that their application increases the overall survival rate of a population sample by a few percentage points, but cannot guarantee anything at an individual level. However, the behavior to adopt depends on the situation, the time of day, whether you're inside or outside a building, and many other factors. So giving advice is pointless because, at that moment, instinct often guides actions. If you find yourself in the midst of an earthquake, you often only have a quarter of a second to decide what to do. In general, one should simply consider that the main risk comes from the collapse of the structure you're in at the moment, along with the falling of furniture and belongings inside. Therefore, it's crucial to identify, obviously well in advance, what might be the most solid points of the structure, usually load-bearing parts, door frames, doorways, and corners, and position yourself nearby. The first rule, in our opinion, is to get under a sturdy table or bed. The idea of standing under a doorframe is just a misconception. People choosing this position would commonly be crushed to death if the door jambs were to collapse under the weight caused by the earthquake impact. You're safer under a table than under a door, especially in modern homes. If possible, stay away from glass, windows, exterior doors and walls, and anything that might collapse, like lighting fixtures or furniture. And especially if you're on a high floor, don't try to use the elevator or venture down the stairs. Stairwells and elevator shafts are the weakest structures in a building. If you find yourself outdoors, the main danger comes from what might collapse, so be careful not to linger or pass under parts of buildings, balconies, cornices, gutters, etc., that could fall. Instead, seek out a clearing or square that keeps you as far away from buildings as possible. A car can provide good shelter, so it's advisable to stay inside one as long as it's not parked under buildings, viaducts, billboards, or power lines. In a seaside city, it is possible that significant waves may occur following an earthquake, moving very quickly. These waves pose a real danger to those near the coast, so it's advisable to stay away from beaches for several hours. There's not much else you can do to avoid increasing the risks of other negative consequences, which only professionals can better assess how to manage. Besides, in such a situation, there's too much unpredictability to afford to waste time doing other things that might seem useful at the time, gathering some important belongings, turning off electricity, gas, etc., but could exponentially increase the risk of further dangers, far from being decently manageable in that situation. Keep calm if you're trapped under rubble. Although it may seem counterintuitive, waiting for rescuers to arrive is the best choice if you find yourself trapped under debris you can't move. Don't use matches or a lighter. Gas leaks and other flammable chemicals could accidentally start a fire. Don't stir up or lift dust. Cover your mouth with a handkerchief or item of clothing. Bang your hand on a pipe or wall so rescuers can locate you. Use a whistle if you have one nearby. Shouting should be a last resort because it can make you inhale dangerous amounts of dust. And speaking of the whistle, well, one can't expect you to always have one on you, but a really useful tip could be this. If you live in a seismic area, try to keep a survival kit in your car and one close at hand at home. A blanket, water, a first aid kit if you can, a flashlight or headlamp, scissors, a phone charger charged, and indeed, a whistle. Of course, always hoping it will never be needed.